This video is brought to you by Setup. I've wanted to make a quick beginner's macOS guide for a long time now. I will try to explain and show you the essentials of the Mac operating system as if I'm explaining it to my friends, something that I've done a lot over the last 15 years. So, throw away any intimidation feelings or doubts that you might have, because the Mac is a very pleasant and easy to use system. Let's start with a few major aspects of the Mac OS that you should know about. The control button on Windows is the command key on the Mac. If you're coming from a Windows computer and you're used to Control plus C to copy, for example, you will quickly get used to the same shortcuts, but instead using command. Command plus C to copy, command plus V to paste. Same principles goes for the rest of the common shortcuts, and I'll make sure to put the most common use shortcuts at the end of this video. So once you get used to using command, going back to control feels less ergonomic. Another thing to understand and get used on the Mac is that it is a very drag and drop oriented system. As you use it, you'll notice that you can easily drag and drop files, text, images, and pretty much everything else all around the operating system. Next, if you'd like to delete something, you can just drag it in the trash can. You can eject a disk by dragging it to the trash, or you can delete a file or an app or even a color from your color palette simply by dragging it to the trash can. The start menu control panel and add remove programs, yada yada, is pretty much non-existent on the Mac. If you don't need something, for the most part, you can just put it in the trash. Of course, if you haven't emptied the trash, restoring it is just as simple. Out of the box, the right click on the Mac is disabled. You can right click by pressing the control button and then click with the cursor, yet the proper right click needs to be enabled in the settings. Don't ask me why. The next thing to know about the Mac is that the apps come in a DMG format. On Windows, we're used to installing files with the .exe or executable extension, but the Mac uses DMG. DMG stands for macOS Disk Image File. When you download a program for the Mac, it's in DMG. Think of DMG as if you're inserting a CD with a software in it. When you open a DMG file, it even looks and acts as if you've inserted a physical disk in the computer. Once you're done with the disk, you can simply eject it. Next thing to know is quitting applications. When you press the X on the app, which we will talk about more in a second, you don't quit the app, you just close the app's active window. Now, some apps can quit themselves when you press the X, but the majority will stay active. If you'd like to really quit them, you can press Command plus Q or go to the menu of the app and select Quit. It's a bit like the iPhone, you swipe up to go to the home page, but the app stays active. If the app freezes, you can force quit it by going to the Apple menu and opening the force quit window. This window shows you all active apps, and you can select and force quit those that might read not responding. As I mentioned, I'll show you some shortcuts at the end, one of them being the force quit. By the way, if you end up enjoying this video, subscribe, because why not? Next up, there's no cut on the Mac, just copy. As I mentioned, the Mac is a very fluid drag and drop operating system that doesn't require to cut things. If you want to move something, just drag and drop it. And the final thing to know about the Mac, and I promise we're moving to the overview, there's no need to turn off your Mac computer. You can just put it to sleep. I might shut down my Mac maybe once a year, if not even less. The rest of the time, I just close it or put it to sleep, then I come back to it exactly where I left off. Don't worry, putting it to sleep instead of shutting it down won't clog it up. Okay, so once you power up the Mac, you're greeted by the desktop, just like on Windows. You can put files and folders on your desktop, just like on any computer. You can even have more than one desktop. This is a useful feature if you run multiple applications at the same time and you want to move around your desktops easily. On the top of the desktop, you'll see the menu bar. If you come from Windows, all you need to remember is that the menu bar is the same as the menu bar on any Windows machine, but it's glued to the top of Mac OS instead of being part of the app window. With that being said, the menu changes depending on the app that is being used. If I open Apple Music, I see the menu bar for Apple Music. If I tap on the browser, I see the browser menu. The two elements that always stay the same, however, are the little Apple logo on the very top left, which is the Apple menu, and the toolbar items on the right where the clock is. Consider the Apple menu as your global menu that always stays the same. It holds the primary functions of the Mac, like shutting it down or restarting it, or simply opening the Mac OS System Preferences, which is like Control Panel on Windows. The toolbar on the right can hold various little icons that could be an extension of an app, like a quick menu for it, or a standalone simple app that just lives in the toolbar menu. On the bottom, there's the dock. The purpose of the dock is to serve as your constant app and Windows holder while you work. You can place and rearrange the apps that sit in the dock so that they match your workflow. If you minimize a window, for example, it slides down in the dock, ready to be expanded again. When you open an app, even if it's not an app that lives in the dock, you'll notice that it appears there while using it. When you quit an app, it disappears unless you tell it to stay there. Now, some apps have little light dots on the bottom. Those dots indicate that the app is active. If it doesn't have a dot, it is not running. You can add some quick access to folders like downloads right beside the trash can. The dock can be modified a lot. It can be as filled, as big, or as minimal or invisible if necessary. Before we move to the next feature, I'd like to briefly mention interacting with macOS's Windows and the Windows on the Windows operating system. The three window control buttons on macOS are on the left side instead of on the right. They are like a traffic light indicating the three primary functions: red, close, yellow, minimize, and green, expand. Each app or window has those little traffic buttons for control, but they are on the left. Okay, all apps on the Mac live in the applications folder. They can be started from the applications folder, yet the more convenient choice would be to use the launchpad. The launchpad lives in the dock, but it can be triggered with a gesture or in many other ways. The launchpad is just like the iPhone, a bunch of app icons that you can rearrange and organize in folders to simply use to launch. Most of macOS's settings can be found by going to the Apple menu and opening System Preferences. From changing the desktop wallpaper to setting up keyboard input methods, and of course, accessibility, including enabling the right click on the mouse, can be found there. Feel free to go over all the aspects of the settings panel to learn how you can customize your Mac according to your choices. At the end of this video, I'll put links to my own process of how I set up a new Mac, which you can use as a guide. The next thing is Spotlight. Spotlight is the little search icon on the menu bar on top, and you can think of it as your global system search. If you look for a file, photo, or even a dictionary explanation, you can do it with Spotlight. You can trigger Spotlight by pressing on the little magnifying glass, but the quickest and most used Spotlight action for me is to use Command plus space and typing right away. In fact, this is how I use Spotlight most of the time. I just summon it, and as soon as I start typing the first few letters, I can hit enter and start the app. I can also do simple calculations on the fly. The Finder is the cornerstone of macOS. It is the equivalent of Windows Explorer. This is the app that allows you to access all your files on the computer. The desktop you first saw when you started the Mac is part of the Finder. By default, for every Mac user, the OS creates a folder. Mine is called Iskren, and under it, you can see some of the default folders that are used throughout the system, like desktop, music, photos, documents, downloads, and others. You can customize the interface of the Finder to fit your needs. I prefer to keep mine as clean as possible and always in list view. I find the icons view confusing and messy. Creating folders in the Finder is very simple. Simply right-click on an empty space to create a folder. If you want to rename it, just press on it again or use the right-click menu for more options. The Finder has a great built-in feature to archive files. If I select a bunch of files, I can quickly right-click on them and choose Archive. And just like that, I can send an archive to someone. As mentioned earlier, deleting something on the Mac, including apps from the Applications folder, is a matter of dragging them to the trash can. By far, the most useful feature on the Mac is the preview of files. No matter if it's a video or a photo, you can just hit space while the file is selected and preview the selection. If there are numerous images, for example, you can just hit space to preview one of them and then use the arrow keys to move around and preview the rest. Talking about preview, preview is the default all-in-one app that can open pretty much anything. Preview can open documents, presentations, images, PDF files, and more right out of the box. Safari is the default browser on the Mac, just like Edge is on Windows. It is a great browser that can work in sync with your iPhone. You can of course install other browsers like Chrome, but I always prefer Safari. The App Store is very similar to the App Store on the iPhone. If you're looking to install new apps, chances are you'll find a suitable solution in the App Store. Of course, you can install apps that are not in the App Store, but we'll talk about that in a moment. The main thing to remember about the App Store is that every app can be considered secure and tested. If you are to install an app that is not part of the App Store, you'll most likely end up downloading a DMG file. When you open a DMG file, 90% of the time you'll have a hint to drag the app itself from the DMG file to your computer's application folder. Think of it as if you're moving a song from a CD to your hard drive. In many cases, app developers show you this action with a little arrow and a shortcut to your apps folder to save you time. Once the app is dragged into the applications folder, the DMG is no longer necessary and can be ejected and later deleted if necessary. If you'd like to delete an app that was downloaded from the App Store, you can open the launchpad and hold on an app until they start jiggling. Once jiggling, you can see the X icon on the apps that came from the App Store that can be simply deleted by pressing on it. Going back for a moment to the drag and drop inclination of Mac OS, I'd like to give you an example by showing you a clever app called Yoink. Yoink helps you drag and drop files much easier than the default method. Think of it as a shelf for your files. Drag files you'd like to move to Yoink. With your mouse free, navigate to their destination, then drag the files out of Yoink to where they're supposed to go. Yoink is a paid app, but instead of paying separately for it, you can take full advantage of Yoink and over 230 plus premium apps as part of Setup. Setup is a productivity service that helps you solve various tasks on your Mac. Instead of individually paying for premium apps, where you'd have to leave credit card details across multiple websites, you can have a one-stop subscription to solve every task on the Mac. With more and more premium apps and features being added regularly, Setup can help you be on top of your productivity game. Try Setup for free for 14 days by clicking on the first link in the description below. The next thing I'd like to point out is iCloud. iCloud is a cloud-based system and storage solution that is an integral part of Mac OS. As soon as you set up your Mac, you'll be asked to sign in to create an iCloud account. You can, of course, omit that option, but I'd recommend you take advantage of it. iCloud allows you to sync your Mac data with your other Apple devices, and if you'd like, you can also take advantage of iCloud Drive. iCloud Drive is like having a hard drive, but online. Whatever you put on iCloud, you can access it from anywhere. I have a dedicated iCloud video on how I use it to run my personal life and my business, and I'll make sure to list it at the end of this video should you decide to go that route. So here are the most important shortcuts you'll most likely end up using. Command plus Q quits an app. Command plus C copies. Command plus V pastes. Command plus H hides an app or a window. Command plus space fires up Spotlight. Command plus Tab tabulates or moves around the active apps. Control plus space changes the language input. Command plus I opens additional info about a file. Command plus F search and find something somewhere. Command plus or minus zooms in and out of text or an interface or the browser. Option command and escape opens up the force quit menu. If you enjoyed this video, chances are you'll find my app playlist useful. If you have any questions, feel free to list them below and consider subscribing. As always, it's been an absolute pleasure. This is E, over and out.